So now let's take a look at some procedures for testing two different population parameters. And we're going to start with looking at two variances. And the way that we compare two variances is by examining the ratio of the variances. Now, the data types applicable is interval and ratio. If you have nominal or ordinal data, this doesn't make any sense. So let's set this up, what's going on here a little bit. Now, having reliable relation or information regarding the mean or the median is really quite often extremely important. However, information regarding the variability can at times be even more important. So let's take a look at conceptually an example here. So let's suppose you have your beverage company and you're considering two different types of bottling techniques, two different machines. Well, suppose this is your number line, and suppose right here is your target number of ounces that you want to be bottling. And you believe the mean from the first machine is, say, here, mu one, say, slightly below. And the mean for the second machine is, say, up here, call it mu two. So it'd be like right there. Well, looking at this, mu one is clearly closer to the target than mu two. So now you've got to make a decision. Is the idea being slightly below or above? Which way do you want to be? Okay, that's kind of a basic thought process there. However, what about the variability? Suppose we take a look at the variability, and for this first process, we see that we have variability that perhaps looks like this. Now, whether that's large or small variability, it's not the point yet. And let's suppose for this second variability, it looks perhaps like this, with this variability clearly being smaller than this variability. So under those conditions, perhaps this second process, represented by mu two, is more desirable. But you would never know that if you didn't look at the variability. The whole idea of looking at variability between two or more processes is actually referred to as process control. And we won't get into that in this course, but that is a whole area of study. How do you control both the mean and the variability of two or more processes that are taking place? So let's take a look at another example. So let's suppose a furniture manufacturer is concerned about the number of blemishes on furniture coming out of the factory. A test row is conducted where the number of blemishes on a specific piece of furniture is recorded for 15 consecutive work shifts, both from the currently used assembly process and a new process being tested. Now, is there evidence to suggest that the new process both reduces both the typical number of blemishes, the typical number of blemishes? That's referring to, see, the word typical. That's referring to either the mean or the median. We have to figure out which is most appropriate, along with the variability observed in a number of blemishes. So we're actually looking for two things here, the typical, mean the mean or the median, and the variability. So before we address the means, I'm going to first take a look at the variances. And the test we'll be using is based on the F distribution. Now, I'm going to initially approach this as if all I was interested in was the variability, just that. And then I'm going to come back and address the means. And when you see what I have to do to address the means, that will probably make much more sense. So for now, we're going to pretend like all we're looking at is just the variability. So what is this F distribution? The F distribution is always positive. We think of it as a positive distribution. In reality, it could be zero or positive, but it's non-negative. And actually, the way it's commonly referred to as simply being non-negative. The F distribution is not a symmetric distribution. It's not like the normal distribution. It's actually skewed right. And just like the T distribution, the F distribution is actually a family of distributions where each member is identified, just like the T distribution, by the degrees of freedom. Remember, for the T distribution, the degrees of freedom was n minus 1. Well, remember, I said we will be looking at the ratio of variances. So what we're really comparing is, say, group one variance over group two variance. So these are two different data sets, data set one, data set two. Now, data set one will have its own degrees of freedom and one minus one. Data set two will also have its own degrees of freedom and two minus one. So we talk about the degrees of freedom for an F distribution. We talk about the numerator and the denominator degrees of freedom. Now we will actually look at the sample variances, S1 squared over S2 squared, to make a determination about the population variances, just like we look at the sample means to look at or to make a determination about the population mean. It's the same idea. Okay, let's take a look at the assumptions. You know there's always assumptions. Every procedure that we use has some type of assumptions we have to address. Now, like other statistical procedures, a hypothesis test based on the F distribution has assumptions that must be reasonably satisfied prior to actually using this particular procedure. So before setting up the hypothesis test and calculating a p-value, we need to at least check these assumptions. And the assumptions, there are actually two of them, that the data was sampled or obtained from two independent populations. We need to have independent data. If our data is dependent, this is not the route to take. And the second is that the distributions of both populations are normal. Now you're going to find in this particular chapter, what we will do is an awful lot like we did in the prior chapters, only we do it twice because we have two different data sets. You'll see when we get to the means, back in the prior chapter, to use a t-distribution, we needed to make sure that the population is normal. So we took a look at either did the CLT apply or is a normal plot reasonable? Well, we'll do the exact same here, only the difference is rather than one, we'll do it twice. We'll check the normality for both data sets rather than simply one of them. So going back up to my data here, yeah, these are two different machines, the current technique and the new technique. These are clearly independent. There's no natural pairing here that you could possibly come up with. So I would have to say something here. Let's see, here we go. I would say, well, first of all, the parameters would be sigma 1 squared. Actually, I'm going to make that sigma C for the current. And sigma nu squared. So I'm going to compare these two variances. Now they're both independent. I'll say just they're different machines. So what one machine does doesn't affect the other. That's kind of obvious. So now let's take a look at the normality. I'm going to need to take a look at normal plots for the current and for the new process. Now, if you look at the sample size, clearly the CLT is not going to apply. And we don't mix and match. We don't use the CLT on one and then a normal plot on the other. Either they're both have sample sizes large enough to apply the CLT and feel comfortable with it, or they don't, so do normal plots. So here we are at TC Stats. Here's the data. And the current and the new, I need to set these. This is clearly ratio, the number of blemishes. So let's look at graphs, do a normal plot on the current, and make a determination. Now, you may say this is not normal because of this and this. And I may agree. For right now, we're going to say that it is normal and proceed as if it were normal. And actually, we're going to use this data set for several examples. And we're going to say it is normal at one point and proceed as if it was normal. Then later, we'll proceed as if it was not normal. So that you can see the difference in the results based on your decision normality. So for right now, we're going to say that it is normal and proceed. Take a look at the new, and this could concern you a little bit. Doesn't bother me too much because some deviations in the center is not nearly as important as the deviations in the tail. I just know that from experience. I will also say that this is normal and continue from there. Now, again, here I'm just going to very, very quickly, it seems to me that normal plot looks something like this. And I need this a little bit longer. Again, this is not like perfect by any means, but it's good enough for my students. You better write this down because this is going to tell me you actually looked at the normal plot. As long as it's kind of sort of similar to what I see when I do the normal plot, then I know that you did in fact actually look at it and didn't just flip a coin. So it just has to be a rough resemblance of it. Now I need to set up the hypothesis test. And before I do that, the statement, I need to go back up and read the problem again, make sure I understand what I'm looking for. We want to know, is there evidence to suggest a new process reduces both the typical number of blood groups along the variability? So I'm looking for smaller variability amongst the new process. So I have the current, my null hypothesis is the current variance divided by the new equals 1. This means that they're the same. Algebraically, this is same as saying sigma squared current is equal to sigma squared nu. Because if I divide by sigma squared nu, I'll get 1 over here and I get this ratio. So algebraically, that's not a big surprise. And then I'm saying that this same ratio would be greater than 1 under the alternative hypothesis because if the new process has a smaller variability, then a big number divided by a small number will be bigger than 1. And I've already addressed my assumptions. I need to do an F test, report the p value, the decision, and the conclusion. So, again, for that, I'm going to switch back to TC Stats. So, I will go back to where it says two samples because I'm now dealing with two samples. And on the bottom here, you see F test. I will select current and new. And see here, the first sample is current, the second sample is new. That means that this is the same as sigma squared current divided by sigma squared new. So it matches what I wrote on my paper. And it's fine the way it is, but in my students, I always tell them just make it equals, just make life easier. The less than or equal is actually technically correct. It's probably more correct, but to me, this simplifies it, and this is what I stress for my students. So, what I'm going to also do is because I have this data, I'm going to click on Use Selected Variables instead of Sample Statistics. If I didn't have data, if I simply had the standard deviations and the sample sizes, I could enter them. And then go ahead and complete the test based on the summary statistics. Now, my data is not stacked. In other words, I have two separate columns. If the data was stacked all in one column, I could tell it the data is stacked and then set the group. So I'm not going to bother that now. You can refer to the user's meta for TC Stats to get more information on that. So I'll tap Update, and then there's my value of F. That's the actual F statistic. Along with my p-value. So, one thing we didn't do, we didn't specify alpha. Because it did not give a significance level, again, as a general rule of thumb in my class, we use 5%. And the p-value here was 0.07, was it 96? Now, this is greater than alpha, therefore, I am going to fail to reject. Now, my students, I also want you to write the value of F, which was 2.1713. See, this is giving me more information. If you have the wrong answer, the more information you give me gives me a better chance to figure out what you did and possibly give you partial credit. So, because I failed to reject, my conclusion would be simply there is not enough evidence to suggest the new process has, I'm going to say smaller. Variability than the old or current, I guess is actually the term that I used. Okay, so that is an F test, and the approach here was as if we were only interested in the variability. And this is extremely important because when we look at the means, this is actually one of the steps that we need before we can complete the analysis regarding the means.